The material in this podcast is for information purposes only. It does not represent the opinions of Vested Finance and is not intended to be investment advice. We recommend you to consult with a financial advisor before committing to any financial decisions. Hello again, everyone. Welcome to episode 15 of our Vested Finance podcast. My name is Kaihan, and I'm an editor at Vested calling in from Singapore. I'd like to begin by saying Happy New Year to you all. Welcome back, Darwin. Happy New Year to you. How are things in the US?
Well, to say the least, it's been a very eventful few weeks in the US, that's for sure. Insurrection in the Capitol and 134,000 daily new coronavirus cases. It's surreal. And there's still a little over a week before our Trump presidency ends. So I think everyone's holding their breath. That said, let's talk about the topic at hand.
Wow, it sounds like an explosive start to your 2021. Right then, let's address the elephant in the room. That elephant being Amazon, of course, which is a massive $1.6 trillion company. And to Amazon, it feels like ambition and growth knows no bounds.
Yes, the company is trying to participate in every segment of commerce.
There's a pretty detailed graph on your blog, which we will link to the show notes, that shows the spendings of shoppers on Amazon. But this information represents only a tiny fraction of the overall spendings of the average US household. So there's obviously room to grow.
Yes, I think when one thinks of Amazon, what comes to mind is this behemoth with almost 1 million employees and a very large market cap. And it's hard to imagine that the company can go up in value another 2 or maybe 3x or maybe more. But in reality, the scale and ambition of the company is quite unprecedented. And that is why we outlined in this blog post, yes, $1.6 trillion in market cap is very large, but it was only about 2 years ago that the company crossed $1 trillion in market cap. And even then, it was hard for investors to imagine a 60% growth, but look where we stand today. So I would argue that the $1 trillion market cap is actually meaningless. If anything, it makes you have an anchoring bias. In reality, there were multiple companies in the past that had much higher market caps. The record was held by the East India Trading Company, which in today's valuation would be more than $8 trillion. Right now, the average Amazon shopper spends about $600 per year on the site. And that number is about $1,400 of spending per year if you're a Prime member. So clearly, Amazon Prime members are more valuable. They not only spend more, but also pays about $120 a year to get all the Prime membership perks. But even this amount dwarfs the average annual spend of the average US household, which according to the Bureau of Labor Statistics is about $63,000 for 2019. So this includes housing, transportation, goods and groceries and entertainment and other things. If you look at the spend by category, the majority of Amazon sales is still derived from the sales of apparel, food, household goods and other discretionary spending. You can see this chart again on our blog, but the spendings on Amazon, really, if you look at it as a part of the whole, still represent the minority of the total consumer spending. So as you mentioned, there might be a significant room to grow. So in order to quickly expand to these other categories, the company can pursue two broad approaches. The first is to enable third-party merchants to sell products on Amazon.com itself, which can rapidly increase the available selection that consumer can have. And number two, expand into other difficult-to-penetrate fields, such as healthcare, groceries, entertainment, among others, which represents a larger share of consumer spend.
All right, let's talk about the third-party marketplace first, which has been growing rapidly over the years.
Yeah, the third-party merchants are independent sellers that sell their products on Amazon.com. They can also optionally utilize Amazon's logistical and distribution network and also customer service for fulfillment. So over the years, Amazon has built this complex system for its own e-commerce business, and now it offers it to others. Amazon charges fees for this convenience, of course. And on this front, the company competes directly with Shopify. The program started modestly in 1999. At that time, the third-party merchant was only about 3% of GMV, the gross merchandise volume, which is the total merchandise value being sold on the platform in US dollars. So as of 2019, about 60% of merchandise sold on Amazon is from third-party sellers. In other words, third-party sellers contribute more than $200 billion in the GMV. So this is in 2019. In 2019, Amazon's total GMV is, including first-party, is about $340 billion. And over the past decade, that grew about 37% compounded annually, which is crazy fast. So if you compare this to Shopify, this $200 billion in GMV from third-party merchants is about three times the size of Shopify's for the same year. Yet, at the writing of this article, if you look at the valuation of both companies, Amazon's valuation, if you look at the enterprise value over sales, which is a measure of valuation, it's about 10 times smaller than that of Shopify's. And we haven't even taken into account all other aspects of Amazon's fast-growing business, AWS, payment, streaming, and others. One could argue that by this back-of-the-envelope comparison, Amazon is either severely undervalued or Shopify is overvalued. Likely both are true.
Let's shift gears a little and talk about some of the other categories that Amazon is pursuing. Let's begin with pharmacy and healthcare. Americans spend a lot of money on healthcare. The TAM, or the total addressable market, for this segment takes up about, 17% of the US GDP, which suffice to say is huge. Yet as large as this market is, there are a bunch of regulatory hurdles and complexities that make this segment difficult to enter. But Amazon, naturally, they step into the fray. What's their approach?
All right, this is an oversimplification. But at a high level, healthcare services can be divided into three types. First is getting access to doctors. Second is getting access to medications and prescriptions. And then third, paying for the above two, mostly with healthcare insurance. Now, Amazon's first effort encompasses all these three into a bundle. In 2018, it announced a partnership called Haven, a partnership between Amazon, Berkshire Hathaway, and JP Morgan. All three companies employed more than 1.5 million people together. With their large employee base, the three hoped that they could do data sharing, negotiate lower costs, and develop new technologies to deliver healthcare and insurance. But after 3 years, the past week, they just recently announced that they're disbanding the partnership for reasons yet to be made public.
Well, luckily, Amazon is not an organization that fears failure.
That's right. Amazon has disparate teams running different efforts to potentially go after the same market, which, you know, the downside is it can be confusing for consumers. But as a result, the Haven project is not the only healthcare development that Amazon was running. To tackle the problem of delivering access to medication and prescriptions, Amazon created Amazon Pharmacy. Back in 2018, Amazon bought a startup called PillPack, which is an online pharmacy startup, for about $753 million. It then turned it into an underlying engine that powered Amazon's pharmacy. With this acquisition, Amazon could plug its massive distribution and delivery network to PillPacks, which had an existing user base, and more importantly, a pharmacy license in almost all US states. And at the time of the acquisition, PillPacks' average revenue per consumer is about $5,000, more than three times the average Prime member spends.
So that's the second service. The company also has a project that supports the first service, right? To give access to doctors?
Yeah, they call this the Amazon Care. It's a telehealth medicine platform. One trend whose adoption is accelerating during this prolonged stay-at-home period is telemedicine. According to McKinsey, up to $250 billion in healthcare spend can be virtualized by telemedicine. So even after we return to normalcy, this trend is likely to endure since it's much more convenient for the patients. For telemedicine, patients can see their doctors much sooner than compared to, say, visiting a doctor's office, where in the US at least, patients typically wait 2 or more weeks to get an in-person appointment. So now that Amazon has the drug delivery prescription capabilities, the next step is to gain ability to deliver the medical consultation, so the first service. This is where telehealth comes in. Right now, Amazon is piloting its telehealth platform, Amazon Care, to its employees living in Seattle. This is one of the benefits of having a large employee base, and it's similar to how the company first piloted its cashierless Amazon stores to its employees in Seattle before its launch. So the Amazon Care platform allows users to have access to video consultation, in-person care, prescription delivery, and chat service. Patients can even schedule an in-house visit by a medical professional if need to. But clearly, there's a limit to video and chat capabilities as a diagnostic tools. This is why Amazon has joined the health and fitness wearables foray, competing with Apple and Fitbit, who's being acquired by Google, by launching Amazon Halo. which is a wearable band. Halo is not a medical device. It is a band that tracks your activities, voice, and even measures body fat. On measuring body fat, Halo asks you to take several selfies in tight-fitting clothing and then uses machine learning to calculate your body fat percentage. Now, privacy concerns aside, the company uses the same technology to sell customers custom fitting t-shirts. So it seems like they're using the same technology and trying to push multiple products using this core same technology.
Well, that's interesting. It's still in its early days, but it seems like Amazon is building more and more services on top of its current offerings.
Yes, and you'll see this time and time again with the company. So let's shift gears and talk about groceries.
Now, groceries and food items are also a large component for the average US household in terms of spending. And Amazon has spent years and years experimenting with different projects to get more revenue from this category.
Yes, so much so that the consumer experience can be confusing. For instance, in 2017, Amazon bought Whole Foods for $13.7 billion. On top of that, the company provided multiple offerings for groceries and household goods. It offers Amazon Fresh, a grocery delivery service that provides same-day deliveries for perishable items. As a side note, this is part of the reason why Amazon invests heavily on logistics to improve its ability to do one-day deliveries. On top of that, the company also has Amazon Pantry, a recurring subscription service for everyday households, which it just announced that it's shutting down. So we'll focus our discussion on Amazon Fresh. Generally, though, there are two approaches to online delivery services. The first approach is picking the items from the store, store picking. If you have an existing grocery store, you can partner with a third-party delivery service, or you can build it all yourself to have people pick up the items and then deliver it to the end consumer, right? The challenge is that it's really difficult to gain enough scale to make this profitable. The typical grocery store has a margin between 2 to 3%. This is because grocery stores typically sell low-cost, undifferentiated commodity items. So if you want to add grocery delivery service on top of that, you have to add variable cost, labor, to select the items, pick it, pack it, and then deliver it to the consumer, making the effort typically deeply unprofitable. This is the approach that traditional grocery stores take because they lack the capital to build their own delivery networks. Instead, they partner with third-party delivery services such as Instacart in the US, and then the negative margin, the unprofitability aspect of the business is absorbed by the delivery service funded by venture capital. Now, this is not to say that it's impossible to be profitable in the grocery delivery business. In fact, Instacart turned profitable in the second quarter of 2020. It just took a massive surge in demand from global lockdown to do so. To be profitable in the segment, you really have to have enough order density for each delivery run to make it profitable. So the second approach is to add on top of your existing delivery network. This approach is clearly what Amazon took, right? They already have a dense delivery network that delivers relatively higher margin items through the e-commerce business. So now Amazon can add grocery delivery to the outgoing delivery trucks, reducing the variable cost contributions from the low margin grocery orders. But the downside is, unlike grocery stores, Amazon did not have the inventory and distribution system that's suitable to handle groceries, which typically have lower shelf lives and are more perishable. That's where the Whole Foods acquisition came in. As the company was building new, smaller distribution centers closer to city centers for grocery deliveries, it used Whole Foods to jumpstart its last mile delivery efforts.
Now on to entertainment. We know that in this category, Amazon's efforts are wide ranging, and they can be broadly split into two categories. One is audio, the other is video. Let's talk about audio first.
So Amazon's first foray into audio was through the acquisition of an audiobook service company, Audible, in 2008. It then followed up with the introduction of Amazon Prime Music in 2014, which is a streaming music service for Prime members, which was then followed up by unlimited streaming service that competes with Spotify and Apple Music, launched in 2016. For Amazon, music streaming does not have to be a profit driver, but rather it's designed to create more touch points with users' daily lives. The more Amazon you have in your life, the more you shop. The music streaming service is priced the same as its competitors, about $10 per month, unless, of course, if you're a Prime member, which it then costs about $8 per month. And if you're an Echo smart speaker owner, the cost is even lower, $4 a month. You can see from the pricing strategy, it's clear that the effort is optimized for maximum adoption. And considering that 70% of US households are Prime members, this effort can significantly hamper adoption of Spotify's and Apple's services.
Along the same vein of entertainment comes video. We all know about Netflix and its dominance in this arena. What makes Amazon Prime's video services content strategy so competitive with Netflix?
If you look at Amazon's Prime Video homepage, you see four distinct categories of content. The first is live sports. The second is movies and TV shows. The third is rent in theater movies, which is an important feature during the prolonged lockdown. The fourth is other streaming subscriptions, where users, viewers can subscribe to other streaming services. At a high level, Amazon's video strategy has two broad objectives. The first is to get more viewers, to get more Prime members. And then the second is to, after you do that, you have a lot of viewers, you sell the ability to access them. To get more viewers, to get more Prime members, Amazon has invested in live sports and then a lot of TVs and movies and TV shows. Live sport is a differentiated offering compared to Netflix or even Disney Plus, right? And then movies and TVs is pretty standard now compared with Netflix and HBO and so on and so forth. So Amazon can gain more users' attention. And then the more time you spend on Amazon, the more likely you convert to join Prime and the more you spend on the site. In 2017, Amazon's internal document around the calculation around this was leaked, and then Reuters published the study. So you take one example, Amazon's TV show, which is quite popular, The Man in the High Castle, which is an original TV show that came out in 2017. This show cost Amazon about $72 million in production and marketing, but it attracted about 1.15 million new Prime subscribers. So if you divide 72 by 1.15, you get $63. This means the cost for the TV shows yielded Prime customer acquisition cost of $63 per member. Now, considering at that time, Prime membership cost about $100 per year, it took about 8 months for Amazon to recoup this cost. So the mathematics, the customer acquisition cost is really favorable on this front. And then you add the additional revenue that's generated from the Prime members spending more, right? So you can see from this is why Amazon's spending more and more on tentpole shows that can attract global viewers. This is why Amazon can spend about $1 billion on one TV show, the Lord of the Rings TV show alone. This is also what makes Amazon's content strategy competitive with Netflix, right? Everyone's trying to compete with Netflix head on, but Netflix has the scale advantage. Netflix can spend $17 billion on content, which is a lot more than its competitors because it can spread that fixed cost over a larger user base. It has 195 million user base subscribers, which is growing rapidly. So in contrast, Amazon theoretically can spend as much, although in reality, it spends about a third as much, and then monetize through premium membership, through e-commerce sales from, you know, selling dog toys to toilet paper. And then going back, taking a step back, the second broad objective. Okay, Amazon creates this very compelling service, right? Prime Video channels, and it acquires a lot of viewers. And now it's starting to sell ability to access these viewers. It's now offering rent in theater movies, which is extremely important now that we have this prolonged lockdown due to COVID. And more importantly, which is probably a lot more enduring business moving forward, is the ability for Amazon to help other streaming services acquire new subscribers. There are a lot of other streaming services that's trying to compete with Netflix, but they lack the same scale as Netflix or the differentiated content that Disney Plus has. So these other streaming services such as Showtime, HBO, CBS, NBC's Peacock, they now rely on the likes of Amazon and Roku to acquire users. So Amazon, through its widely viewed Prime Video channel, becomes a user acquisition engine to these other streaming services. It extracts a fee for every subscriber that these other streaming platforms acquire through Amazon. And it's reported that this revenue in 2020 is about $3.6 billion. That's no small change, right? Roku is an independent public company. Funnily, it actually stemmed out of Netflix. But it makes streaming boxes and operating system for smart TV. But the business model is identical on this front. It actually helped streaming services acquire subscribers, but their revenue is about one third that of Amazon on this front. And in addition, both companies actually get revenues from selling low-cost streaming hardware and then generate additional revenue from advertising from these platforms.
And finally, we arrive at the topic of the internet. I'm going to sound like some cave hermit here, but I always thought that the internet was set up via a mess of underground and deep sea cables. And now there's a new technology that can deliver internet via space?
Yeah, due to innovations in rockets led by SpaceX, the cost of sending satellites to low Earth orbit has declined significantly. With the introduction of SpaceX's Falcon Heavy, for those who don't know, SpaceX is a private company led by Elon Musk. The cost of launching payload to the low Earth orbit has gone down by 20 times. This lower cost of delivery, coupled with innovations in low Earth orbit satellites, in short, LEO, it is now feasible to deliver internet via satellites that can give you good speed and allow you to deploy your service globally without laying down cables all over the place. This means lower capital expenditures, right? You still have to spend upwards of $10 billion initially, though, to create the constellation of satellites that blankets the planet. Both SpaceX and Amazon are planning on launching between 3,000 to 4,000 satellites to low Earth orbit to create the constellation necessary to do this. But then again, you don't need to spend the capital expenditures to build ground infrastructure at a global level. So once you build the constellation, you can deliver high-speed internet to everybody on this planet, which is amazing. So SpaceX has a program to do this. So does Amazon, called Project Kuiper, which is in partnership with Blue Origin, which is Jeff Bezos' private rocket company. The implications of this low-cost global internet deployment can be massive. Imagine you have high-speed internet for everyone, everywhere, whether you are in rural United States, sub-Saharan Africa, or even rural India. You will have access to fast data speed. To our listeners in India who are familiar with the changes that Jio brought when it made data super abundant and super cheap there, it could have a similar effect. Internet penetration shot up and demand for devices and media consumption and e-commerce transactions grew. So these benefited US companies tremendously. US companies Amazon, Netflix, and Facebook, especially in India. Reed Hastings, the CEO of Netflix, went as far as to say that he hoped someone would do a Reliance Jio in every other country. And that's what Amazon and SpaceX are trying to do. So on top of that, if you're just speaking about US specifically, internet providers are some of the most hated companies by consumers because they typically have regional monopolies and poor customer service. Yet the average US household spends about $60 per month on internet service. And if you bundle that with TV, that spending goes up to about $200 a month. As Jeff Bezos has famously been quoted, your margin is his opportunity.
Well, that's it for this week. My brain is already saturated, and we haven't even covered all of the ways that Amazon makes money.
Yeah, stay tuned for part two next week, where we talk about the other arguably more important businesses that Amazon's pursuing, from fintech to Amazon Web Services.
To our listeners, we hope you've enjoyed listening to this episode. For more insights into markets and emerging technologies, please visit our blog at vested.co.in. As always, take care and stay safe.